Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four horsemen, the gospel writers. The Holy Spirit used them, used their personalities to pen the gospels. It's like if you're watching, let's say, a documentary about one person, and then you see another documentary about the same person, another and another. That's sort of what the gospels are like. Matthew's documentary was written primarily to the Jews, Mark primarily to the Romans, Luke to the Greeks, and John kind of universally. We know that Matthew owned a thriving accounting business. And back in the day, the bean counters, they could do this shorthand that was unbelievable. It was better than most of our apps. You know, we have these apps where you can speak into them and it'll write. I mean, it was like that. And you can see the Gospel of Matthew, how organized it is, like someone who is an accountant. John Mark, we know about him. He was a young guy. Luke was a physician who wrote to the Greeks. And as you read the Gospel of Luke, you can kind of feel like a doctor, a surgeon is sort of writing that. And then, of course, we have John, and you have basically the Gospels. The Gospels talk about the person of Jesus. Now, this is hard to comprehend. No one can get this, even though, you know, you think you can, you can't. The smartest minds ever have grappled with this and they don't understand it. God sent Jesus because our greatest need was forgiveness, because we're sinners. Jesus was fully God and fully man, 100%. I don't understand it. I can sort of get my mind around it, but not totally. The person of Jesus, Jesus had emotions like you and me, but his were perfect. He got angry. He laughed. He cried. He was drained. He had to grind it out in so many ways. Jesus is our sympathetic Savior. Jesus also drafted a dream team, the disciples. Have you ever heard of a guy named Tom Brady? Anyone? Here's Tom Brady's scouting report before he entered the NFL. Poor build, skinny, lacks great physical stature and strength, lacks mobility and the ability to avoid the rush, lacks a really strong arm, can't drive the ball downfield, does not throw a really tight spiral. He's a system type player who can get exposed if forced to ad lib. He gets knocked down easily. That's the greatest football player, arguably, of all time. The disciples read like Tom Brady's scouting report. A ragtag bunch of people, blue collar, white collar, bad language. Some had type A personalities. Jesus is picking these cats, yet they turned into spiritual Tom Brady's, didn't they? Jesus met all sorts of people. The Gospels talk about this. He met with Zacchaeus, the IRS guy. He met with Nicodemus, Nick at Night. And he told Nick at Night, hey, you must be born again. He met with a rich young ruler. He talked to crowds from all sorts of backgrounds, and he welcomed the kids. He would say things that kids could even understand. The person of Jesus. The Gospels also talk about the power of Jesus. Jesus worked miracles. His first miracle was at a wedding. He turned H2O into Merlot. He had the Hebrew Happy Meal, fed 5,000, one Happy Meal. He healed the sick. The blind could see. Cast out demons. Brought people back from the grave. Miracle working power. How about the preaching of Jesus? 2/3 of everything he said was about stories. Stories, 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 stories. Whenever I speak, I try to tell stories. The story, as I said earlier, the meta-narrative of Scripture. I attempt to see myself in the story, and I try to put you in the story as well. When I talk to people and they maybe mention a sermon, they never say, oh, I like your outline, or I like that video. No, no, well, here's what they say. That story you told. That story. The style of Fellowship Church, we're a biblically functioning and biblically communicating church. So we take the story and we take a page out of Christ's playbook and we deliver it that way. Jesus used things that were common to his day. He used like a sower, a fish, a piece of bread, some water. His culture, oh, I connect. If you ever get bored at church, don't blame God, blame the communicator. Because God is not boring. Jesus preached, he taught. And then everything pointed to the cross. He died on the cross for our sins. And because he was 100%, right? Because he was totally righteous, death couldn't hold him down. He conquered the grave. So those of us who know Christ personally, we will, when we die, resurrect in a new heaven and a new earth ultimately. But on the cross, the Lamb of God spilled his blood for your sins and my sins. Then he rose again. In fact, everything in Christianity, everything rises and falls on the resurrection of Jesus. After the resurrection, Jesus appeared to many people. At one time, he appeared to 500 people. Hey, lawyers, how would you like that case? You're talking about evidence that demands a verdict? Wow, 500 different witnesses. It would last longer than the O.J. Simpson trial. That was a little laughter for those who were 45 and over. See, the Bad Bunny, that thing was for the young people, you know, and then O.J. Simpson trial. Some were like, who is O.J. Simpson? Google it. You know, you might have seen it on Netflix, that documentary, I think there's one about him. Speaking of documentaries, have you ever been enthralled in maybe a Netflix show? It might have 5 or 6 seasons, and you're so freaked out, you have so much anxiety, you go, I'm gonna skip to the last episode and watch it and see how it plays out. Have you ever done that? I have. And I'm like, oh, that's what happens. And then I watch the other seasons, but I know what happened in the end. That's what we have in the Bible. We know what happens in the end. We've seen the final episode, and we win. Those of us in Christ, because we've received the good news, we win.